Frank, you describe this teaching of imputation in your book in terms of methodological Protestantism. And I wonder if you might explain that and also say a few words about how you understand this teaching to compare with the teaching of the Catholic Church.
Well, I don't actually entirely disagree with what Timothy said. Also anticipating this question, having received them ahead of time, I have jotted down a few notes as well. One thing that's, I mean, I actually, before this, a couple of days ago, actually reread portions of the Council of Trent to sort of beef up on this topic. And one of the things that I actually agree with Timothy in this sense, that the idea of forensic justification or imputation is clearly not absent, or it's clearly present in pre-Reformation theology. But I think the difference is that, as I understand the Reformation view, that imputation at justification or at the initial conversion is exclusive of infused righteousness. In fact, I'm going to quote here from the Council of Trent, which says this: if anyone says that men are justified either by the sole imputation of the justice of Christ or by the sole remission of sins to the exclusion of the grace and the charity which is poured forth in their hearts by the Holy Spirit and remains in them, or also that the grace by which we are justified is only the goodwill of God, let him be anathema, unquote. Now, if you read it carefully, Trent is not denying that justification involves imputation of righteousness. What it is claiming is that it is wrong to think of justification as imputation alone. And it seems to me that the unique contribution the Reformation brought to this discussion wasn't that the whole idea of imputation, but that imputation at initial justification or justification is something that is different from the inward change that occurs during sanctification or what is sometimes called regeneration. Although they are not inseparable. One of the difficulties of reading this literature, especially Calvin and Luther, and I think Timothy's already alluded to this, a lot of these guys are sort of thinking this through. And so if you pick them at one particular point in the evolution of their thought, you're going to miss maybe something else. So I say inseparable. Now, in that sense, I don't think the division between Catholics and Protestants is that great when it comes to the relationship between the life after conversion, in terms of the relation between works and grace. If you read many Reformed thinkers, including Calvin, they argue that a life of good works, a life of sanctification, naturally follows or ought to follow from one's conversion. Catholics argue that the grace one receives through the sacraments as a consequence of the spiritual disciplines and so forth, and as well as the initial grace of one's conversion, allow one to in fact engage in acts of charity, works of mercy, and so forth that change you from the inside out. So in both traditions, you do have a relation between faith and works. I think the distinction ultimately is whether initial grace is imputed or infused. I mean, I think that's the real rub. And I say this in the book, that I give the illustration of the Protestant who always goes to the altar call. You know, you ever see, there's always people, maybe you're one of them, who, there's an altar call, and every couple of weeks they go down, and I call that Protestant confession. Because essentially what it is, it's a way to sort of renew your spirit and do this again. That person who's sort of the obsessive compulsive Protestant who's not sure whether he's saved is similar to the obsessive compulsive Catholic who does 100 novenas in order to get enough grace. I mean, this is, so you find, I think, within both traditions a kind of personality that lends itself to both sorts of extremes. But I think at the end of the day, if you look at the theology, both of them, in fact, have a place for both sorts of activities or understandings. Ultimately, though, I think the distinction has to do with imputation versus infusion. I think that's where the real work is.
Yeah. For the sake of some of us who may not be entirely clear on what those terms mean, imputation and infusion, I wonder if, Timothy, you might offer a brief definition, and then responding to Frank's comment, maybe say something about where the ground of one's justification is, whether it's in the past or the future, and how that influences the issue.
Yeah. Well, imputation is really based on the text, several texts in the New Testament, but one in particular where Paul is referring to Abraham. This is in Romans chapter 4, and he talks about his faith being counted to him as righteousness, or being imputed to him as righteousness. And it has to do with the fact that this imputation is not based on what Abraham did, his good works, but rather upon God's gracious favor to him and the counting to him of the grace of God. Now, he's talking about an Old Testament figure there, Abraham, but it becomes a kind of paradigm for the Christian understanding of conversion and the way of faith. Infusion is a term, it really comes from the Middle Ages, and going back to Augustine, gratia infusa, infused grace, was understood to be something that was imparted to the individual sinner through primarily the sacraments of the church. It was the grace of God which enabled that person to become a Christ-like individual over a long period of time, extending beyond this life, perhaps even into purgatory in the next life. And so infusion versus imputation is, as Frank has said, I think rightly, one of the key paradigm differences between Catholic and evangelical ways of thinking about it. One of the most helpful documents that really looked at this issue in historical context was a document published in 1999 by the Lutheran World Federation and the Pontifical Council for Promoting Christian Unity, called the Joint Declaration on Justification. And in there, they looked back at the 16th century, and particularly the statements from Trent, some of which Frank read, and also the condemning statements from the Protestants that were aimed at the Catholics, and they asked this question. Against what were they addressed in the 16th century? What was the target of their criticism? Was it really something that the Reformers taught or that the Catholics believed? And on the basis of that kind of very fine historical investigation, they were able to say, as faithful Catholics who still affirm Trent, as all faithful Catholics must, and as evangelical Protestants who stood in the tradition of the Augsburg Confession and the Calvinist Confessions, that these mutually condemning confessions of the 16th century need not lead us today to mutually condemn one another, because our understanding of grace and works do not match that against which the condemnations of the 16th century were aimed. Now, I'm not defending that. I'm saying that is a very interesting way of reframing the question today that I think we have to take into consideration. Even at the end of that, though, the 1999 statement was not sufficient to say we have no church dividing differences over this. There was still added to this statement what's called an annex, a little appendix, about the question of simul justus et peccator, the same time just and sinful. This is a famous slogan of Luther and the Reformers. And Catholics have a very difficult time of affirming that. In fact, can't, according to this statement, and they expressed a reservation. For Protestants, it expresses a very important thing about this question of imputation and infusion, and the way in which, as Calvin said in his commentary on Galatians 2, we are justified by faith alone. But the faith that justifies is never alone. It is accompanied by works. Works flow out of it. And so we differ, to put it in Protestant language, on the way we distinguish justification and sanctification.